Hi, welcome to N3RD4IA, the program that goes above and beyond usual nerd things. Today's topic, Great Gatsby. Saw the movie when it came out in theaters, read the book twice in my life. Second time reading the book, I was kind of like, this is like, these people are so terrible! All of them, except for the narrator, Nick Carraway. But all the same, I was excited for this movie because all the decadence and all the 1920s stuff and the prohibition and the speakeasies and the sit-ins and everything else, it's just so exciting. I don't know why it's so exciting to me, but it just, it's a fascinating decade to me. And also, it's a Baz Luhrmann movie, so I was very, very excited to see it. As for those of you who don't know, Romeo and Juliet, Moulin Rouge, Australia, not the best, but still okay. But I absolutely love Romeo and Juliet and Moulin Rouge. Two of my favorite movies, and they have been since 2000-ish, 2000 and something. But yeah, and I'm glad Baz decided to bring Leonardo DiCaprio back to his latest movie. Leonardo DiCaprio has evolved in leaps and bounds as an actor since his portrayal of Romeo. And he hasn't lost any of his flair. He still looks good. Whatever. What have you. Great character actor he is. Baz Luhrmann just has this thing where he makes a great spectacle of everything. Like music, visuals. Very particular about which actors he chooses. And I love that about him very much. Okay, so I just rented it on the Redbox and I watched it for my second time of watching. And first I want to talk about how it compares to the book. The characters are pretty exact to the book. I don't think they use Jordan Baker, the golf pro, who I think is a tennis pro in the book. I don't remember exactly. But anyway, Jordan Baker is an interesting character. Because she seems to be interested in Nick, but at the same time, she seems to be playing him and leading him along and just making him do what she wants to do. There isn't so much of that in the movie, and I wish there was a little bit more because although her character has a dynamic with Nick as far as introducing the Gatsby and the connection to his family and everything, but it's still kind of distant and not utilized so much in the movie. So I think it would have been a great buffer to the way that Tom's kind of just in charge of Daisy and everything that she does. It doesn't matter how many times he cheats on her, how many people he messes around on her with. If she does something wrong, she's horrible. But anyway, her, great portrayal. Daisy, a little bit two-dimensional, but it's also, that's kind of how Daisy is purposely made. Because she's so stuck in a situation that is beyond her control in a lot of ways, and she just becomes nothing in the end. Isla Fisher does a great job as Myrtle, who's Tom's mistress. And Nick Carraway is great as Tobey Maguire because Nick is the narrator, but he's also the outsider. And the plot of the story revolves around everyone else, and he's just the observer of it. Person that's left to tell the story. Okay, so all that's pretty good. Follows the book pretty much to a T, except for a few things. Basically, Gatsby's this guy, a really rich guy that throws all these lavish parties. And he lives next door to Nick. And Nick gets a personal invitation to one of his parties, and he's there. It's like, where's Mr. Gatsby? I don't know, I haven't seen him. And he gets that kind of response from everyone. It's like, yeah, he invited me. He invited you? He doesn't invite anybody. Well, he invited me. So there's that, and then there's his cousin Daisy, who is married to Tom, who is very, very horrible, racist, Wall Street type, Yale-y, just not a very nice guy. And he's messing around with Myrtle, who's the wife of this guy, Wilson, who runs a gas station. And Tom is trying to sneak off with her to his own little private apartment that's just for her, and Nick's kind of just like, no, I don't want to do this. But then he's kind of like, well, I'm here now, and I don't know what to do. But then he finds out that Gatsby does all this stuff to impress Daisy, who he's in love with and always has been. And that all he does the parties for is the hope that she might come to them. Tom's kind of on to the thing, like, immediately. But at the same time, he doesn't really get involved until it starts to explode. Okay, so that's about it, sort of plot, I guess. There's this whole thing where human beings are walking, talking contradictions. And this movie is great evidence of that, because Tom's like, I don't know what Gatsby does for a living, it's kind of shady, blah, blah, blah. I'm a businessman, I'm really rich, and he's just some poor son of a bitch. And then you're like, but you go to all these speakeasies and things, and you're drinking, and you're doing whatever, and you have a problem with what this guy does for a living? And you're just a downright horrible person? I don't get that. Because Daisy's one-dimensional, two-dimensional. Daisy is a very unlikable character in the end, but at the same time, I feel really bad for her. Besides the fact that she does something horrible and doesn't fess up to it. But that's kind of what happens with Tom when Myrtle gets hit by a car. He's just kind of like, oh, I don't know this woman. He's like, I never do. And, I mean, he was right, but at the same time, he should have come out and said, hey, this might be my fault. It might be. Partially my fault that she even walked down into the road in the first place. But, you know, I don't know. What I really wanted to talk about was the modern touches with the music and such, and Baz has this way of making current music or recent music into something that fits the era that his movie takes place in, which I really think is kind of cool. So yeah, a lot of like current hip hop or dance music is like mixed in 20s style sounds, and I was a little weird about it, even though I did like the soundtrack. But then the more I thought about it, especially like some of the party scenes, it makes a lot more sense when you compare it to the now, and how you have all these people that are like, oh my god, that person's a junkie or a drug addict or whatever, but, and then, you know, they go out and party all the time, and they have a problem with someone being a certain way or doing a certain thing, and just completely judgmental of everything. And that's the way so many of these 20s people that we see in this movie are. So there's that. There's the fact that you could technically make any kind of music sound like any other kind of music and have it come out okay. That's cool. Really great cover of Love is Blindness by Jack White. Well, by U2 originally. Definitely my favorite. Also, Lana Del Rey's Young and Beautiful, and a few other kind of like mix and match kind of things. But I do think that a lot of this hedonism is part of the modern times, and it really, the music fits the tone. And of course, Gatsby wouldn't be Gatsby without the eyes of T.J. Eckelberg watching over the scene. You know, as in from the famous picture on the cover of the book. Giant pair of glasses with the, like, everything happening underneath. Yeah. But that's all I really have to say. I'm very curious to see what Baz Luhrmann would possibly tackle next, but Gatsby's a good choice for him. Really pretty. And really depressing. But it's good. Watch it.